Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Morning.
Morning. Morning.
Here we are in what is formally known in preaching circles at Good Shepherd Sunday. The lessons are always, the collect is about Jesus being the Good Shepherd, and the lessons always have something to do with that capacity of Christ to be the shepherd of our souls. Now, most of us have been in old Victorian churches where, particularly the ones called Church of the Good Shepherd, where there's always a wonderful window of Jesus with this cute, cuddly little lamb. And sometimes the lamb is over his shoulders, and sometimes it's looking adoringly at Jesus, and he's got him in his arms, you know. But Jesus didn't say that we were lambs. He said we were sheep. Now, one of the great things about my Middle Eastern heritage is that I actually have people, I think, who still live over there, some of whom are really shepherds. That's what they do for a living. So I know a thing or two about sheep herding. And the first thing that I need to tell you about sheep is they are the dumbest creatures God ever made. They may be cute and cuddly when they're little lambs, but they are really dumb. And their design is stupid. This is true. You know that when a sheep lies down, if it moves over on its side a little bit too much, it can't right itself, and it ends up with its feet in the air, and it can die because the weight of its body presses on its organs and it suffocates. So one of the jobs of the shepherd, why they have that crook, is to right the sheep. They fall, after you've seen people fall asleep and kind of nod off, you know, if sheep nod off, they could die. In addition, unlike cute little lambs who are tagging along after their mommy, sheep are willful. They go wherever they want. They wander off to here and there. And so part of the reason that shepherds have jobs is to keep the sheep from wandering off, because there's danger when they wander off. They could lie down, fall asleep, and roll over. Or a wolf could get them, or they're dumb enough, they could lose their footing, and they could fall off a cliff. Now, the other thing that people don't know about shepherds is they imagine that there are great flocks of sheep. Well, in the Middle East, no one's that wealthy. They don't have sheep farms. They have one or two sheep per household. And so a village hires the shepherd. And every morning, the shepherd comes out and wanders along the path, stopping by the houses, and he calls for the sheep. And the sheep, who know the shepherd, follow along after him. Sometimes there are little picket fences, and they open the fence for the sheep to come out, and the sheep come out, and they follow the shepherd because they know one thing that all of us know, and that is you always follow the person who knows where the food is. And that's what the shepherd does. The shepherd takes them to various pastures where there is food for them, and then spends a lot of time wandering around, making sure that the sheep don't wander off or don't fall asleep and roll over. That's the two jobs of the shepherd besides bringing them out and bringing them back. And being a shepherd is a very tedious job. I have an uncle who's a shepherd, and he says, whoever wrote "The Lord is my shepherd" didn't know anything about being a shepherd. No one would assign that job to God, because that job is hard work with little remuneration, taking care of a bunch of willful creatures that are not their own. And that's the important thing to think about when we think about, I think, Jesus being the Good Shepherd. That we are willful and wander off. As my uncle says, the only thing dumber than a sheep is a chicken. And sometimes we're not even as smart as sheep. And we wander off and we go on our own way and we do things, and Jesus keeps chasing after us. Now, you know, you all know the story about the parable that Jesus told about the shepherd who leaves the 99 and goes after the one. And we always think, yeah, that one. You know, we know that one. There's one in every crowd, right? after and bring him back. When I get it in my mind that something is right, because I have a Middle Eastern in heritage, I'm stubborn, and it's very hard to shake it loose. When I get it in my mind that I'm going in this direction, it's very hard to get me in that direction. And what I need, what I long for, is someone who will show me the right direction in spite of what I think the right direction is. Someone who will say to me, Jim, cut it out. Someone who will take a stick and write me so that I don't do damage to myself or to anybody else. Someone who cares enough for me that he is willing to risk his life for my benefit. Someone, in short, who knows that I belong to him, but never acts like I belong to him. Someone whose love is so compassionate, so strong, so caring, so present, so vigilant. And when I think about that part of what I think Jesus' ministry is, I'm amazed. I'm amazed that for 2,000 years in the post-resurrected life, Jesus has cared for countless millions of folk and spoken to them in that voice that they can hear and called them to himself and called them to follow him. It is a miracle every Sunday that people come to church. It is a miracle that you're here. And the reason that you're here is because you have heard that voice. Jesus has called you. And this part of the week centers us. It gives us a place not only to come and be recharged, but also to remember that the shepherd of our souls is not ourselves, but the one who calls us each by name and leads us to the place where heavenly food is all the time. Amen.
Amen.